So, thank you for the introducing words. My talk is on JavaScript, JSX Graph, and Stack, but I won't show JavaScript code if I'm not asked for that. So, let's see. Okay. So, first, I just introduce myself and the activities on e-assessment in engineering mechanics at our University of Applied Sciences. What I think, what the potential of JSX Graph and Stack for e-learning could be in my courses. And as an example of that, I show the e-assessment of free body diagrams. First, I explain the task and the requirements, and then I show something about concept and implementation from the perspective of a Stack user. So I will show the interface from the Stack side. So I studied in Moscow, Freiberg, and Berlin mechanical engineering, and did my PhD at Technical University of Berlin in mechanics of materials. And then I worked for, I think, 14 years in the aerospace and in the automotive industry. And since 8.5 years, I am teaching at Technische Hochschule Brandenburg, and mainly busy with engineering mechanics, first year students, material science, finite elements, and product development. And besides of some materials and structures research, I mainly focus on software for teaching and also design support, so to say. There is one free software which I'm very much involved in, SMAT Studio. And nowadays, I am getting up and running with Stack and JSX Graph. So, why should I do that? In the traditional course of engineering mechanics, we have, let's say, for example, one block of lecture, one block of exercise. And that means I'm solving problems at the blackboard, and the students take notes and ask questions, if any. If they are fast enough in thinking to have questions. And then there are optional sessions called tutorial, mainly run by students. And in the end of term, we have an exam, and the question is, how can I get better results from them and have more efficiency in my teaching? And the problem is that there is no enough time for self-paced problem solving because the pace of the problem is so different. And if I would wait for them, it will take 5 times longer than just if you know what you are doing. And they need to have possibilities to have asynchronous learning, so when they are on their own. And but still, they need, of course, immediate feedback. So not to poke around and not knowing what went wrong because the result's not the correct one. And so individual training should be better supported. And on the motivation side, I provide weekly homework assignments, and the students can earn some bonus points in the exam if they hand that in and if that is correct. And usually this is based on automatic assessment in Moodle, which is our learning management systems at our university. And for beginners, so that was my experience, that is very complex. So I didn't know anything about quizzes, question banks, question types, and things like that. And you really need a individual training or sort of training in order to get started. I was not able to do it from the docs. And 7 years ago, I wrote my first calculated question and equipped my courses with a lot of these questions. And last year, I had a getting started in Stack questions. And So I won't go into the details about Stack because that has been mentioned here earlier and everybody is aware of that. Just a comparison of these two types of questions is here is an example. The calculated questions, they have just one result or input field, and they can just accept numbers. And you can say right or wrong. And the Stack questions can have multiple inputs and they can accept numbers or expressions, and even could use units, which is not made in the examples here. The units you see are behind the input fields, but that's easy to change, which I learned meanwhile. So if you have a quiz with two types of questions of first and second generation, you can compare the facility index and the discriminative efficiency. These are statistics results from students' response in Moodle. And a question is considered to be better if the index is higher. So it's the students, more students can provide the results if the facility index is higher. And the correlation between the result in the individual question and the overall test result is strong, then the discriminative efficiency is high. So guess which two questions are first generations and second generations. Of course, the right ones are first and the second, the left ones are second. And the, for instance, the low discriminative efficiency says that it is random whether a student is good in the test or not, if he managed to respond to this particular question correctly. And there is no miracle about that because the questions are quite, or the problems are quite complex. You need to do a lot of calculations to solve them. And if the final result is wrong, you have no clue what might be the problem. And if you have intermediate results, you can go step by step through that. It's also sort of scaffolding for the solution procedure. In a sense, you give away the solution procedure a little bit, but that is paid off by the increased facility and the better, I mean, the higher acceptance. So I just think that Stack is worth using because it's a powerful open source tool and there is active development, and we just recently had a conference on that, and which was very interesting as well. I like more content developing contents and writing programs for grading rather than grading paperwork from the students every week. And so that's so for me that is more attractive. And also the instant feedback during the homeworks is also appreciated by the students. So I think it is worth doing it. Of course, it is not so easy to do it, at least for me, with no one around who already did that. That's also why I try to get in touch with the community. So the next step I want to go is improving these questions, adding more questions. And one of the technology based for future work is JSX Graph, which allows me for dynamic graphics. In the right here, you see an example of a randomized question. So the system geometry is randomized and is displayed in that way. You could have a static sketch as well and provide figures for the dimensions, but that is a smarter way, I think. And also it's very attractive that you can have input from these graphs, as we have already seen in the conference. And when I grade the exams, then I frequently see the poor sketching skills of the students. And that is something that needs to be trained. And So even in distant learning, it is not so easy to look at the paper of the students and give them feedback. So I think some graphics related feedback is essential for mathematical modeling, for graph analytical methods, and just for their visualization skills. And I give some examples of that. We have the concept of strain is how do we describe strain by strain components, and what sort of shape distortion does that provide, and the correlation between that is to be sketched, and you can also convert that into stack questions with JSX graph. And there is one option: you display a distorted shape and ask for the strain components, or you provide the strain components and ask for the displaced shape. And that is where the input via JSX graph comes in. And but that is sort of the easy one, because existing objects are just modified, and that can be done in the standard way, as also in the documentation of stack. So another example of a graph analytical method is Morse circle, which is related to the eigenvalue problem of second order two-dimensional tensors. For instance, strain or stress. So you have stress components in a given coordinate system, and you can compute, or you can by sketching find out what the principal stresses are and what the principal directions are. Same applies for moments of inertia of cross sections of beams, for instance. And a way to implement that is you just provide the stress components and ask the students to put the circle and the line for the principal direction to the right spot. And also this can be implemented by modifying existing objects. Another one which I would like to have someday is a sketching tool for shear and moment diagrams. You have to provide, that's what I asked them to do by hand in the exams. And so it is a way to derive the shear and moment diagram from the load conditions just by geometric reasoning. So you do normally, you have to integrate twice, but you can do it by computing the area under the lines and then build the straight lines and also parabolic second order parabolas based on their tangents. And but that is the future. That's when I'm done with the free body diagrams, I will do that perhaps, or someone else will handle that. So finally, we come to the free body diagrams. What are free body diagrams? And on the right, you see a mechanical system with support and members. And if you want to find out the forces in the members, then you have to remove the supports and replace, or the environment, and replace that, the action of the supports by forces. And then you have some vectors and can derive the equilibrium conditions out of that and compute the forces. And this is also a JSX graph applet, which is not part of a question, but just for experiment. You can move around the supports and see what happens to the forces. And you can also see the difference between the system and the free body diagram. And if you want to have that for arbitrary structures or mechanical models, you need to create elements, you need to remove the members, you need to add forces, and you need to name them appropriately. And you then have to access from outside what has been created, what has been removed, in order to check whether that was correct. And here are some other examples. On the left, you have the system. On the right, you have the free body diagram. So you remove the support and some parts of the system, replace that by forces. And for instance, another alternative to just removing support is also to replace distributed loads by their resultants. And you can have multi-body parts or systems, and then you need individual separate free body diagrams, but they need to be consistent in order to stick to actio equals reactio. So they have to be of opposite sign, but the same name. So what is the basic requirement for a free body diagram editor? You need to add forces and moments. You need to provide appropriate names. And these names can be expressions as well. So M times G for the weight, for instance, or 3U0A for the resultant of a distributed load. And an important aspect of these free body diagrams is that these forces, they are not known in advance usually. So you just provide unit vectors in a sense. They do not need to have unit length, but just their length, just their direction and their point of application count. So how would I evaluate that? I try for, you can evaluate free body diagrams in standalone. You just check the right number, how removed environment parts are, if they are correctly replaced, for instance, various types of supports, or distributed loads. Then another aspect is the consistency with equilibrium conditions. So you ask the students for providing these equations and check whether that matches their sketch they just provided. And also if they come up with the correct solution of these equations. And I already mentioned the consistency between multiple free body diagrams, but that has not yet been implemented. I just tried to come up with a feasibility demonstration. And feedback, of course, is then derived from whatever errors that they produce. So in the proof of concept, the current state is that I can, based on the objects created in the editor, I can provide the sum of forces and moments, so that proves that I can access all these objects and I can handle them in the computer algebra kernel of the stack questions and in a clean way. So I do not have a bunch of floating point numbers here, but this is quite close to what one have on paper with pencil. And of course, this is also a relevant aspect of relevant reference for later grading of the response, because that's teacher's answer. Yeah, how was that implemented? I use the standard communication between Stack and JS XGraph via a string input field, as this has been recommended by the documentation. Some initial setup is statically handed over via this init, this static transfer. And then I started to create a library of standard objects and methods. So each object has a constructor, has a data method which returns its current state. And it is made such that this return state is a list of whatever strings, other lists. And I can reuse this contents of this or the result of this data field for the constructor to create the same object again. That's meant by the last line here. And of course, in order to have a full featured free body diagram editor, I need to activate, deactivate objects, gray them out or things like that. And also to delete something which I created in the wrong way. So how is the interface from the author's side of the stack question? So if I want to create these two objects in the initial setup on the top right, you see the and moment and the force, and in the red box you see what you have to provide as a problem specific contents. That's a list of lists, and each list defines an object with the required parameters and names. And all the reminder is problem independent, because that's just helper functions for later evaluation. And in the problem description, in the CAS text field for question description, I have two input fields, which can be hidden later. And one input field is just the string input field in the standard communication recommendation. And there is a second one, which I had to use as a workaround, because there's a problem. When I want to generate equations for the CAS system out of the object description in JavaScript, I need to convert the strings into variable names in Maxima. And this usually done by the eval function, but that is forbidden because of security reasons in Stack. And I use another field, an algebraic input field, where I put in a set of a list of names. I just put from the JSXGraph site, I put a string in that field, but it is taken as an algebraic expression and conveyed to Stack this way. And the nice thing is that even this M times G or Q0 times A is conveyed there and can be used. And the other field is just for storing the state as it is standard. And that's working very well. And in the feedback variables, if I want to compute the equations I showed initially, I just need to provide a reference point for the moment, and I need to provide the name of the length units to be used for moment calculations. And so this is the only part of which is problem specific. And for displaying of the equations, I use just these three lines in the potential response tree and tries. So that's what I've done so far. If you want, I can, or I just show after some minutes for a live demonstration. I think you should see that now. So this is a Stack question with just this graph inside, and I can now type in some variable name, let's say AX, create a force, and then I have to move it around somewhere. Then, of course, maybe some A, Y. Okay, then some other force, which I just leave like this. And when I press check, then something should happen. Okay, here you see the equations generated out of that. And now we have the starting point for a very interesting class of Stack problems to as a training ground for our students. And yeah, hopefully this will come to a mature point in the current term, so that I can use it at least in the next summer. This is all done just in my spare time. In the beginning, I forgot to mention that there is a co-author. That's a student who recently started to join these activities, and he has shown remarkable learning curve, and also already provided some of these graphs which I showed initially with more circles and this strain, so that I thought it was right to mention him here. So given the importance of these modeling steps, I think they should not be kept outside e-assessment in mechanical in engineering mechanics, and I'm happy that I already can be convinced that having such questions is possible with Stack and JSX Graph. And I hope that this approach is more or less efficient for generating such problems. And I am also hoping for criticism to my code and some input on what I could make better. Thank you for the attention, and have a interesting last talk just now.